And now let's turn our attention to a special segment, and that will be the My Android Story, so that we could get ourselves a good cheer regardless of what Samsung has done, has not removed or has removed, and what Facebook is doing to get into our privacy. How about now we hear it from our friend Pierre from France with respect to his Android journey. Pierre, give us your story, my man.
Hello, everyone. My name is Pierre Aubry. I have been blind almost since birth, and I had a retinoblastoma which declared itself when I was less than a year old. So I wanted to talk about my Android story, my history with Android. As you are interested in, it's pretty fun to talk about, if I can say so myself. So I've been using Android since 2017. Before that, I had an iPhone 4S, but it was pretty much like a dumb phone. It was a smartphone, of course, but I didn't use it very differently compared to, let's say, the Nokia feature phone I had before. And that's because the data plan I had as a teenager was really limited. Like, I had 50 megabytes of internet, so there wasn't much I could do with it. And I have been keeping this iPhone 4S for quite some time, perhaps 3 to 4 years, keeping it on iOS 7. And when 2017 came, I wanted to change everything: the data plan, the phone, and the OS. So that's I initially wanted to go for Android when my Nokia was stolen. The reason I went for an iPhone instead was because back at the time, Android accessibility didn't have a very good reputation. I don't know about the US, because you started with Android much before me, but in France at least, it didn't have a very good reputation. So I went with the iPhone. So in 2017, I was initially going to buy a Samsung Galaxy S8. It was a very anticipated device from a popular brand, and I thought I could just start with that, but was a bit hesitant, especially since the device was a bit expensive. I went to my carrier, and after that, I decided I would take some time to reflect on that. And eventually, I got introduced to OnePlus by a French podcast called CCTech, and the podcaster was presenting the OnePlus 5 at the time and demonstrated the talkback, the accessibility, the few flaws it had in that regard, but it was really, really mostly usable. I realized that there were many brands I didn't know about, and there were at least probably many of them. And I made a lot of research, and I learned about many things, Android skins, and why it was not a good idea to get an Android phone from the carrier if you didn't want later updates. So skins updates, side loading, XDA, custom ROMs. I learned about all of it. And then I decided that for at least for my first contact with Android, I would choose something that was stock Android, or at least relatively close to stock. Back then there was the Pixel 2 and the Essential Phone. They would have been excellent choices, Unfortunately, they weren't officially available in France. I could have, I guess, imported a Pixel 2 from Germany, so it wasn't that easy, I believe. So I didn't do it. I wanted a high-end phone, and that left me with a few options: Nokia 8, Sony Xperia XZ1. Was especially interested with in the XZ1 Compact coming from an iPhone 4S, the Nokia, the Sony, or the OnePlus 5T. And even, I eventually chose the OnePlus 5T. I got it in early 2018. And it wasn't the closest to stock. OxygenOS wasn't the closest thing to stock. It sort of got further and further from stock as it evolved. It shipped with Android 7.1.1 Nougat compared to the Sony, most notably, which shipped with 8.0 Oreo, or 8.0, I'm not sure how you say it. But it wasn't the most accessible out of the box. I think it wasn't, especially compared to the Nokia. But I think it was a device with a relatively good specs for a relatively low price. And I went for it, and I think that's overall the best choice I could have made. It was quite an exciting first contact with Android. And the fact it wasn't completely accessible played a bit, quite frankly, especially with the update to Oreo. And the problem with the dialer, with the fact that you had to literally long press a cipher to when you, each cipher when you were dialing a number. That was frustrating, but then I already knew about an official Google dialer, sideloading, and also I already had the solution to the problem. So that let me the occasion to practice what I learned about sideloading. I did it for the dialer, I did it for the camera. The phone itself otherwise was pretty good. It felt fast, pretty optimized. Didn't have to OxygenOS is known for let's say controversial RAM management and resulting in delayed notifications. I didn't have to complain with that too much, at least until the Android Pie update. And the phone was cool. It had its flaws. It had a mediocre speaker, mediocre vibrator. If you had a Nexus 5X or 6P, you know that vibrator. It was, again, relatively inexpensive, and the charging technology, the dash charge, 20 watts dash charge technology was ahead of the competition at the time in terms of both charging speed and heat management. The phone charged quickly and hardly heat up at all. You almost couldn't feel it. It was quite impressive. I enjoyed this device for the most part. I felt like, especially in security updates, the OnePlus was slightly, perhaps, overrated, because I often had the security updates at the end of the month or at the end of the other month. And the only very notable exception was the August 2019 security patch, which they deployed pretty quickly for some reason. But Besides that, I like the phone. I yet have to try to install a custom ROM on it. Right now, it's in my drawer. Because even after I got the phone, I still got very interested in Android, in smartphones, but most notably in Android and how it evolved and the new smartphone releases and such. And in the middle of 2019, Asus released the Zenfone 6, and I was very impressed with the specs. They released it, probably released it, but they presented it a few days after OnePlus, which presented the OnePlus 7 Pro back then. And they said for the 7, excuse me, the OnePlus 7 Pro, they said for the 7 Pro, they put a 4,000 milliampere hour battery, the pop-up, yes, it was a pop-up camera, and they said it was not enough for headphone jack. And a few days after, Asus presented the Zenfone 6 with a flip camera, which is even more useful than pop-up, especially if you tend to do selfies of or video conference. And the Zenfone 6, it had that flip camera, it had that 5,000 milliampere battery, which was relatively rare in 2019. It's much more current in 2020, actually. And it had the headphone jack on top of that, and it had pretty rare features. It has that notification LED, it had a proper triple slot with two SIMs and micro SD, which was extremely rare on flagships, even on affordable flagships such as this one. So there was that phone, it had all these features. And relatively clean software with a few cool additions, a bit like Oxygen, but without the RAM management issues it usually comes with, and other differences, but kind of same philosophy. And I was really impressed and interested by this phone. And I also wanted to experience stereo speakers. And in February 2020, I bought a Zenfone 6, which many say it's hard to find, but in France, it was in France not too hard, surprisingly. And this phone also had its few flaws, very slow VoLTE rollout, few accessibility flaws here and there, in the latest version of the skin, the new UI 7 with Android 11, and also the stereo speakers are not that good, because the stereo is done with the earpiece, and it lacks power compared to the loudspeaker. The Asus ROG phone line is known for very good stereo, but the reason I got for a Zenfone instead is because they usually have better software support. It's not a problem with this particular line, the ROG phone line. It tends to be a problem with so-called gaming phones in general. Asus, when it comes to updating gaming phones, they aren't even necessarily the worst. But their Zenfone 9, which is supposed to be the more mainstream series, usually gets better support. And it wasn't so super consistent, but it was, when it comes to security updates, it was better than OnePlus overall. It depends, it's not too great right now, because probably because there are they have multiple devices for beta test for Android 11. Otherwise, I have had mostly monthly security updates, and sometimes I receive them pretty early in the month. So yes, ZenUI has its flaws when it comes to accessibility, but it's pretty cool. For example, they emphasized it on the last iteration. It has all those battery care features, charge limit, scheduled charging for the night, the kind of stuff you would very likely find on a Sony Xperia devices. You can now find on Asus. So ZenUI and this phone, I could probably go into more details in another occasion. As far as iOS goes, as I said, I didn't give it too much of a chance. If you ask me if I would give it another chance, perhaps provided I could use Face ID with attention mode, and with given my prosthesis for right eye and the surgery I had where my left eye is, it seems rather unlikely, and I can't imagine choosing an iPhone if I can't use Face ID with attention mode. The SE 2020 is pretty interesting, but the battery size, for example, is what has me worried. And most importantly, I'm happy with Android, but I'm not completely against giving iOS another chance. It's just that I yet have to test attention mode, Face ID attention mode, and if I can't, then there's no buying an iPhone. If I can't use it, there's no buying an iPhone for me, especially since in Europe, they tend to be quite a bit more expensive compared to in the US. So yeah, Android, I like. I don't adhere to every evolution it had. It has known. In fact, do I tested Android from 7 to 11? My favorite version so far was Android Oreo. The fact you had that accessibility volume for the first time, but the fact you could clean all the cache at once without resorting to ADB, the volume control was so cohesive. You could, if you're listening to media, it would modify media volume. Otherwise, it would modify ringtone volume. And if you kept a finger on the screen, it would modify accessibility volume. And that cohesiveness, I feel like it has gone almost entirely through the window with Pi, Android Pi. Android Pi, honestly, for me, felt like a downgrade in several aspects. Volume control, it feels a bit better with Android 11. I'm not sure if it has to do with Asus or with Google, as Asus has added a few modifications, such as modify ringtone volume by default, or and such, and it felt a bit better, but probably because Asus in their current skin, it's like, how about a bit of Nougat or Oreo on top of your Android 11? So both phones I really liked. They had a few flaws, but they were good specs with mostly good software and relatively affordable. And I guess, again, I could talk about them in more detail on another occasion, perhaps. So yeah, that's it for my history with Android. I hope I hope it was fine enough. I know it was long, and I write English somewhat often, but I don't speak it very often. I try to do good accent, I know, but I may fail because it's not my native language. It's French, of course. But as I said in my email, I really enjoy your podcast. So I wish you can keep up the good work as much as possible, and wish you the best. Bye.
So Pierre, thank you for that long story and a detailed story. Yes, the OnePlus 5T brought back good memories. I got the OnePlus 6T, so I hope our listeners enjoyed the story.
Thank you so much, Pierre, for that wonderful story.